tranquility. さじ4杯ドラム新米少々アティッカブルースを味わってください。アティッカブルースを味わってください。
Actual facts, the ghetto reacts to warfare's rare bullets miss you by your hair. Survival of the fittest, hell for the three-time losers, the prisoners of enemy maneuvers. Hold down the fort, cause life is short enough to get it taken. Forsaken where your mental plane's breaking, concealing a 4 pound with every area we surround. Cause clown, I get down for my crown. Take you to the streets for the honor and respect, connect the lethal. Plus my young guns are unbeatable. Aiding and abetting the foul is a violation. That's why my retaliation is premeditation. The invitation is to run with a crew you can't do. And too great to infiltrate from a nickel plate. I state this be the illest ever known on a rush. Swerving with the crush. By criminals creeping through the city, I stop on the block to chat. The thugs with all the drugs, fat cat stepping off the set now, hand on my tool, thinking how bad I wanna flip on that fool. Times are wasting, chasing these punks for petty loot. When there's a real mission to execute, I put the plan in effect. Forget what you heard when you get the word from first and third. For real, I got the fam and all my soldiers to feed. With the yardie gunslingers on staff, puffing weed. Envision the prison that I walk through, leaving any witness when I'm about to handle my business. No escape from the duct tape and artillery. Now tell me, big man, where's the money when the damn thing wonders? Cops play for medals, killers play for corners. In the middle are your sons and all your daughters. Who gives the orders to chaos and mayhem? Who has the proper guidance in mind to save them from this cold world of heartless ghetto dwellers? Pimps to prostitutes and dope sellers. Fellas, strive to be the lead, not follow. Ladies, you can be the queens of tomorrow. Dig it, I want all that and more for my peeps in the struggle to shelter. Food, clothing, and shelter is essential to maintain the hardcore from the sort that push me to the edge, but I can't fall off. My battlegrounds keep the sounds of babies crying, gunshots and cursing. Can you feel my reel? Here's the deal. By any means necessary, go all out and keep this live, cause only the strong survive.
Thank you. There's a thin line between genius and insanity, and they think what we're doing is madness.
Thank you. beware the beast man, for he is the devil's pawn. Alone among God's primates, he kills for sport, or lust, or greed. Yea, he will murder his brother to possess his brother's land. Let him not breed in great numbers, for he will make a desert of his home and yours. Shun him, for he is the harbinger of death.
Dr. Octagon, paramedic fetus of the East with priests. I'm from the church of the operating room with the strikes of force, scalpel since the Holocaust. I do indeed in greed explore, meet the patients, back the rooms with the nurse with the voodoo curse. Holding up office lights, standing at huge heights, back and forth, left wing, swing to north, east and south with blood pouring down your mouth. I come prepared with the white suit and stethoscope, listen to your heartbeat, delete, beep, beep, beep. Your insurance is high, but my price is cheap. Look at the land. Blue flowers growing by the purple pond. See the polka dots. Blue flowers growing by the purple pond. Yellow indigo. Blue flowers growing by the pond. Look, it's raining yellow. Would you care to listen to any more? Thank you. Holding bags on down right from the hospital. It's a patient's work to keep the germs off the turf. Cybernetic microscopes and metal antidotes. Two telescopes that magnify the size of a roach. Three computers to cup a coffee planet with my hand and astral planet detached. Turn on rare foggers. Cut the light on the kid and turn it bright on. Supersonic waves combine and burn his brain waves. I see the mascot of evil. He's not Knievel. Shakespeare's gone. Don't even think about him. Yes. As I go into the park, I see blue flowers, it's raining green by the pond. Blue flowers, it's totally raining green and pouring. Blue flowers, I smell the bees and the birds. Blue flowers, different aspects of life. Blue flowers.
Thank you. Thank you. So, yes, welcome along. My name's ASI. You've been listening to a MoWax retrospective. I am journeying into the complete unknown here. I've got Simon Palmskin Productions and Tony Attica Blues Nuatuku on the other end, and I'm about to try and bring them into this. I don't know how this is going to work. Now, I'm wondering if we've got sound from these guys. Can you hear me? Hang on. One second. I can hear you just about. One second. Play some music while we're waiting to sort this out. I hear you guys. Can you hear me? Sure, I've got sound. I can hear you just about. Why so quiet? Right. Oh yeah, I can hear you. You are there. Hello, Simon. Hello, Tony.
Hello.
How you doing?
Not too bad.
Good. Glad you could make it.
How you doing?
Can make an appearance.
My mum's still what? We've got more than one.
Glad you could make it.
On the stream.
Yeah, hang on. Yeah, let me just turn off all of my other things that I've got going on. Because there's a. Right. Okay. Professional, aren't we, to the last? Good evening. Thank you for joining me. So, basically, just been playing a bunch of MoWax records, and I don't know if you got to catch it at all, but obviously, there's a few beats in there from your fine selves. And I just thought it'd be great, to have a chat with you guys, find out a bit more about your involvement with the label, just some stories, just be good to hear, because it's a label we lots of us grew up with, and it was massively influential. So I'm going to go back right to the beginning, and I literally only just found out, obviously yesterday, that you guys actually knew each other pre MoWax.
Tell me how it all began.
Destination X.
Indeed, there you go, Si. You know that. Yeah.
I found a 12 of T Plays It Cool this morning.
Oh, really?
Yes.
We're going there, aren't we? We're going there. So, see, not a lot of our people know that. You know, I'll put that one quiet. So Destination X was a club that I ran. We were both at Oxford. Simon was in the formal place. I was in the informal place. I was at the quality. Simon was at the uni. But what brought us together was our love for music. You know, I love for black music, essentially. And I ran this club, which is an opportunity for me to, to learn about DJing and learn about making records and meeting like-minded people and, met Simon through that whole process. And what I remember distinctly was, back then, it was very kind of cool to have like live musicians playing at your events. So Simon was one of the first musicians I ever worked with, in terms of bringing congas down and kind of playing at our events, playing percussion, and it was awesome, and it was just really good to meet someone who had a similar passion for music. It was just really, really exciting. And also, particularly in somewhere like Oxford, which is obviously really well known for the university and its colleges, it was really good to kind of meet someone, who was from from a different place in terms of, university, but, brought together with the love of music, and we were able to bring people from both our fields together. There were other people at university, big up John, big up Matt, etc. And also people, obviously from the poly side of things, and it really brought us together because we loved the music.
I mean, it's funny because Oxford was an interesting place with music. I mean, James was from Oxford, of course.
Yes, yeah, exactly.
And then there were those black sound systems like Save the Dance Floor, and they were kind of more into their kind of ravey, kind of hardcore stuff, and just there was a lot of music bubbling around there.
Yeah.
That club scene was so, it was that whole kind of soul to soul time.
Exactly.
And it was just, it was stripping away the kind of, you kind of think about those kind of, it's the word provincial, I don't know, like towns that are small, but the nightclubs being kind of Velvet and called Sparkles or Lately's or whatever, and going to, what was that club called?
Bogart's.
But once you were in there, there was none of that. It was just an empty room with people who really, really loved the music.
Yeah, but with that said as well, there was, I distinctly remember in the first year, do you remember there's a Caribbean Club, which was a community centre that, primarily, was all about kind of, local music, reggae or whatever, but, you could also hire it. So some of the better clubs, hired that space, and some of like really inspirational musical experiences in Oxford were at the Caribbean Club. And we actually hired it a few times for ourselves to do parties. But I'm glad Simon alluded to, again, similarly with Bogart's, under normal circumstances, those kind of places were, more like pickup joints and, very kind of mainstream, music, nights that appeal to, kind of more of a mainstream crowd. So it was almost like a fantastic contrast when we kind of, hired those places, and the irony of the kind of music we're playing, amongst chandeliers and such. But then that was also the beautiful thing, because particularly with Bogart's, the actual owner was a really, really nice bloke. He was really into music. He definitely helped us out with the kind of events that we put together, and having a safe, a safe space to, enjoy the music out of the room.
You're right, and it was really safe. And that's the kind of privilege of being in a town like that. We were kids.
Yeah,
really,
exactly. Yeah.
Anything. Yeah. And there was so little risk, and I didn't have to think about it. If you were trying something like that in London, there'd just be so much more at stake in terms of, you could just try stuff because there was, it was just safer, I suppose, which is nice for when you're learning.
Exactly.
When was this? What sort of period of time are we talking about here?
87. So 87 for me, that's when it kind of kicked off. And I remember 88 distinctly because, you know, that was the year of Soul to Soul. And, you know, when Back to Life went to number one, you know, we were, as a crew of people, you know, we were on that whole Soul to Soul thing from dot, because we were from London anyway. And you know, we had this kind of, you know, because we were into the music and into the scene already going to clubs like the Wag Club in London and knew about Shake and Finger Pop and all these kind of sound systems in London, you know, we're obviously able to bring a lot of that music to Oxford and have a kind of like we're a few months ahead of the curve, I guess. Yeah. So we were able to, you know, kind of, you know, bring records earlier to people than they, you know, and it was really exciting in that particular 88, you know.
I used to, my sister who lived in Oxford as well, she had a job that took her down to London for half the week, and I used to give her a list of tunes to bring back from Red Records in Beach.
And
she was, you know, she was a professor. She was like, she'd wander in, she's 7 years older than me, she'd wander in and say, do you have Recognition by the Demon Boy? And they were really nice to her. And then, but like Tony's saying, we had that London thing of like tapping into stuff a little bit quicker.
Yeah, and it was great because, you know, we kind of, you know, particularly back then, you know, we all know it was pre-internet and we all know, you know, the industry was different then, but, you know, it really meant something when you had music before people, do you know what I mean? And you were that crew of people who played a particular, you know, particular style of music before everyone else. And also say, as well as Soul to Soul, you know, 88 was obviously very significant because it was, you know, the summer of love, you know, so the whole acid house thing blew up. You know, again, we were the first to wear smiley t-shirts, you know, the first to play Nowhere Back by Adonis, or the first way, you know, you know what I mean? You know, a lot of those records that, we, you know, inspired us, you know, we could play early on and kind of help, you know, other crews as well, obviously play that music. But I think for us, you know, particularly Simon, you know, we had this really good combination of, you know, kind of, you know, dance music of that time, yep. Whether it was acid house, whether it was acid jazz as well, because we were both big acid jazz fans.
Yeah.
You know, as well as kind of more deeper, you know, kind of percussion based records. I could find it. So if I say to Simon their particular name, he'll know exactly what I mean. So if I say to you, Charlie Rouse.
Oh, on the corner.
Yes.
Yeah.
That was a big one at the time for us. I mean, so records like that.
My cocky is downstairs.
So there are certain records that mean a lot to us. You know, even records like you know, even a whole bunch of records. You know, I remember, you know, at the same time, bands like The Influence. You know, so yeah. A friend of ours, Ajax Scott, was involved with The Influence. So The Influence, you don't know the band,
yep.
Kind of soul, yep. R&B band.
I know.
And we had their white label, you know, when we had a copy of their white label, you know, we used to play that at the Destination.
That's some great tunes. That band, Good Lovers.
Yeah, amazing. So we were in a really, it was a really special time, you know, definitely in obviously UK dance music history, but also for us, you know, having our kind of London swagger in it.
I'm interested to know then, like, you know, obviously you guys are sort of pushing this sound in Oxford, which is obviously world renowned for the, you know, the university, and obviously Radiohead came along as well. So probably quite a strong rock kind of heritage. Was there a culture clash, would you say, at all? Like, you know, was it a bit of a battle for you guys to kind of get people interested in what you're doing?
Yeah, I know Simon loves to say about this, but to me, you know, again, something Simon said something about us, we were young and naive, do you know what I mean? It's like that definitely had a lot to do with our passion and dedication for music. But also, because we were doing clubs outside of the kind of normal kind of student union sphere, you know, doing a club, say, at Bogart's or at a Caribbean club, it was open to everybody. So we got to know a lot of locals through music, do you know what I mean? And to this day, I'm still friends with a few people from back then who are locals, you know, who used to come to our clubs because, you know, obviously they were into the music. But also it's a safe environment just to do what you want to do, do you know what I mean? So
yeah, and I think,
so I think,
you're right that it was Yeah, it was a small group of people, and because yeah, the mainstream would probably be more into kind of the rock and indie side of things. But it just meant that the people who were into it were really, really into it. So
yeah,
you get the same people at all the nights. You knew you'd have a full club. You knew you'd have the support. And I was thinking about from like you're saying about the internet, and pre that, you everything happened so much from hanging out at record shops.
Yes,
And it was a social thing, and you met people, and I guess what happens now is scenes develop because people hang out on virtual record shops, and they're on chat rooms, and they're on forums, and they're on. But it feels weird to me because it was such a person thing. You knew the people around, and even moving on from like college days, but going to the clubs. I mean, my life in the early 90s was such fun. I was like, okay, I had no money, but I just like cycle into town, try and buy a couple of records. There was a pizza place on the corner of Piccadilly Circus where for £1 you get a slice and as much coleslaw as you wanted.
Yeah,
okay. Through that. And then you knew a few people on the door, so each night you'd be on a guest list for like, there'd be Slow Motion at Maximus, there'd be Respect at the Wag, something at, was it Samantha's or Annabelle's? I can't remember.
Samantha's,
yeah. But everybody knew each other. I mean, I've got friends from, I literally just knew from we'd be shouldering each other, trying to like smile, actually thinking I want to get in first.
Yeah.
And then we'll be inside and you knew each other. And it was really, and I love that. I love that we had that. And, you know, this is not me saying, oh, it's not like it was. But I do feel like there's something about the digital domain that, doesn't seem to be quite as person driven. I don't know.
Yeah, it's changed. Everything's changed. It's very, very different.
It's amazing because you can hang out with somebody from, you know, Mozambique or from Dakar or whatever, and it's that's incredible.
Well, and I mean, put it this way, I mean, I'm able to reach out to likes of yourself and Tony purely through online kind of connections initially, which that probably wouldn't have been possible. Well, it definitely wouldn't have been possible in those times.
I mean, you know, definitely people are a lot more accessible. I mean, look, I think there's, you know, there'll always be this debate about people who knew, say, Clubland or finding one's identity with music before the internet and after. Do you know what I mean? They're not mutually exclusive. I think there's something really special about at the times like when we were growing up in our early 20s, at a time when the internet wasn't around, you had to invest in the tunes. So you had to obviously know what record shops to go to, because mainstream shops, particularly back then, only had, like, say, a small section of specialist music. Whereas if you went to the right shops, Simon mentioned Red Records, there's Groove Records, a whole bunch, Hitman Records, a whole bunch of records in Soho. You knew where to go. You know, the world was always there, as long as you had cash. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, so.
And there was always that brilliant thing where you get to, I don't know, you start at Black Market and then say, oh, I just sold the last one, but I think matey's got one in that alleyway where Sounds of the Universe used to be. Yes. You run around there. And think, no. Tony just got it, but he's at Bluebird in Edgware Road. I think they've got it. And bomb it round there.
Yeah. Nice.
Yeah, it was a mission. But you also knew that, you know, if you had that track, you were, you know, not that you're part of a special clan, but you'd almost, you know, you'd tick that box. You've invested this time into finding the music, which you obviously heard on pirate radio. You heard of specialist stations. So you're part of this kind of crew of people. But then also on top of that, you know, when you went to clubs, you know, as Simon mentioned, you know, you get to know people either by what they wear or how they look. You know, and or how they express themselves on the dance floor, you know, and then you'd probably end up meeting them on the bus home back. Do you know what I mean? On the night bus, you know, so, and then you get to know them as human beings, you know, and you know, everyone's, you know, most people obviously got some kind of other life, either as a day job or being a student.
Yeah, and you say night bus again. There was an economy there where, you know, it was usually like a £2 guest list or something. You know, you could afford that.
Yeah,
you could afford that income support or enterprise allowance or whatever.
Yeah.
Whereas, you know, guest lists now, it's a different matter going to
I don't think they even really exist these days, guest lists as such. You know, it's not like back then, I reckon. I don't think it's a thing as much.
I mean, and again, it was Honest John's. That's how I got to know James. It was from hanging out
with
Honest John's.
Which is going
to, you know, he was like the YTS boy.
Yeah. That's what's going. Yeah. I mean, that was going to be my next question. I mean, how did you both meet James Lavelle. How did it all start?
Yeah. Well, I met him at, there used to be a record shop in just off Cowley Road called Holy Cow. And I actually met James there. You know, I think that his first job. You know, he was from Auckland.
Yeah.
And he was working there, so I got to know him because he was the dude who knew about the tunes. You know, as a you know, record shop that had obviously all kinds of music, but had like a really small section, maybe about 25 recording, that had, you know, some of the tracks that we were, you know, kind of records that we buy in London, you know, both in terms of imports, but also records that were licensed by UK labels, like Polydor or whoever. And he was the guy to go to. He was our equivalent of a Nicky and Black Market record. Do you know what I mean? You know, so
yeah.
I got to know him there, really. Mm. And then it didn't really, you know, our paths didn't really cross clubland at all until after Oxford. I worked as a programmer for that and hated that because it was really boring. It wasn't really, I knew I liked programming, but, you know, programming COBOL for banks wasn't really my thing. So I got a job in a shop called Turnkey, which was a music shop.
I know it well.
Yeah, so they had Soho Soundhouse in Soho Square next to Sony, and then they had Turnkey on Charing Cross Road. And, you know, I worked there pretty much for, you know, minimum wage, but I obviously had the opportunity to be amongst equipment, and you could take equipment home to learn, you know, and that, you know, my early demos, Attica demos, were based on borrowed equipment from there. But I met Charlie. Charlie used to come in every so often, and I used to have, in that kind of environment, you know, there's two kinds of people. There's one kind of person who is all about commission. So when a customer walks through the door, you look, okay, have they just been signed to Sony? They'll have a budget, do you know what I mean? I'll get major commission. Or you have people who were like me and just musicians and just, you know, want to be around music, and obviously you want to make money, but you're more interested in people, right? So
yeah.
So Charlie came in and he was interested in, I can't remember what it was, the drum machine, but I got to know him just by someone who used to come in, because he used to work in a hairdresser's quite near there. And we just got to know each other one day. And then he calls me, or, you know, in a conversation, like, oh, you know, I want to make a, you know, I know this guy James, you know, let's make a record. I was like, oh, James, I'm in Oxford, blah, blah, blah. And then the next thing I remember is that we were in Mark Angelo's studio in Clerkenwell, making an EP, you know, and this was in a space of, I don't know, 6 months or something. I'll go into more detail, but it was really interesting how things kind of, you know, post Oxford, you know, entering the real world post studies, so to speak, but also knowing that music was the thing I wanted to do in my life, but just how to do it, I didn't quite know. So that was almost like a lesson that I met Charlie.
Yeah, with. Well, it's the old cliche, isn't it? That happens so often, which is it's just a chance, a chance encounter or something. I mean, I've been, again, two record shops that really set me on whatever unlikely path it's been.
Mm-hmm.
It was Reckless Records,
mm-hmm.
and Patrick Forge, and Honest John's and James.
Mm.
And Patrick Forge, I went to see it, went to the Fez in Paddington.
Yes, standard.
In Kevin Beadle. And I'm fresh out of college, and I'm there with a friend, and I say, oh, I want to play percussion in this club. And I don't know how. And they said, well, look, there's a bloke DJing. I asked him. I was like, I can't. And I did. And Patrick went, well, come talk to me tomorrow in Reckless. And we had a chat. And I think I went into Reckless twice. And I mentioned that I had an Atari and that I was programming a bit, literally didn't know what I was doing. And the following week, Patrick called up and said, I'm doing a remix. Do you want to help me with it? And the week after that, he said, oh, there's a band on this new label we're talking, want to do it. And at that point, he hadn't ever heard me play or anything. And I said, yes.
Play creative, right?
Yeah, creative, yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
I was doing a tour in Germany with them.
Wow.
And the same thing with James. I lived on the wrong side of the Harrow Road from Honest John's, and we'd just walk down there and hang out. James just, Mo Wax was like a cardboard box at the back of the record shop, and he was just kind of getting it going, thinking. And then we'd chat and I'd just hang out, nothing better to do. And then one night at Tung Kung Fu in Cotton Garden, I went down, I went down with a cassette and I said to James, hey, I've made a couple of tunes that I quite like. And he went, oh yeah, and put one on and just dropped it. And, you know, no one stopped dancing. So
nice.
Literally the next thing he calls and says, do you want to make a record out of that? And that was the first EP that was on that I did for my wax. And that, it just came from, again, being with people, chatting to people. And I mean, a great thing about James in that regard, and a lot of people in his, with that kind of character do this, is that he didn't wait around. He loved just saying, right, fine, we'll try that. It was all about what's possible. And that was an amazing energy. I mean, chaotic energy and infuriating at times, but amazing. And I could never have that energy. I'm the brakes, and whenever anything, anyone goes, go, I always go, I don't
know. Yeah. Was that the Time and Space EP you're talking about, Simon?
That was the one with Like Brothers on it. So I guess that was called, what was it called? Getting Out of Hell EP? Every EP had a title. I mean, what did we, such inflated opinions of ourselves. It's just three tracks. It doesn't need a title.
And so at what point did you guys realise, you know, that you were sort of part of something, you know, special? Like it was not just some nerdy kid, you know, who's got some ideas and then actually, this is going places.
For me, there's one really distinct thing, which was just, I still love that it happened because it's so kind of cheesy. But 1993, I went to New York for the first time and walked into a club and my tune was playing in the club and I totally lost it really badly. Rushed the booth and went, it's me. But I thought, wow, I didn't even think it was for sale in America. What was that? And then I kind of thought, okay, this must be, I didn't think it must be my tune that's done it. I was thinking, well, Moax is obviously a thing. It's like a force, I don't know.
I think mine is, there's a, what they called a Braveheart tour in 1995, which is, a tour to kind of promote, you know, Moex artists. So there was ourselves, Attica, there was Peche, DJ Shadow, James, DJ, a couple of other artists. And it was like this big tour bus. And we, you know, we went to some cities in Europe. And, you know, I think for me back then, I was just a cave person. Do you know what I mean? I just was really interested in this. I didn't care about press. I didn't care about that stuff. What I cared about is music, you know. So, you know, I remember preparing to perform, you know, work on rehearsals and then having these shows that were really, really well received, you know, and almost like freaking out a little bit that, oh gosh, this is, you know, a lot of people know about this, you know, beyond our little circle of people, you know what I mean? You know, and these were, you know, this is across Europe, you know, Paris, you know, cities of Germany, all over the place. It was really, really, really exciting just to see this music that we're making has a context and has a kind of broader context, you know, kind of on one level it was kind of like, you know, beats led, hip hop led ideas in whatever form artists chose to take of it, and also connecting that to other music at the time, which at that time was obviously the whole kind of drum and bass thing was beginning to take shape, you know, people like Peche and you know, Rupert Potek, and it was a really interesting interplay between, you know, kind of what the ideas that we were coming from, the kind of hip hop perspective, you know, but it's all underpinned by beats and exploration of beats, you know, and then obviously on top of that you had your whole kind of like, you know, the artistic vision of, you know, Ben and Will, which was obviously phenomenal, you know, I think for me back then, because I was so in it, what I could clock as, oh, you know, oh, it's pretty cool, you know. Anyway, back to the 909, you know, back to the bricks.
There always be that thing where you'd go into the office, once there was an office, because there was an office for ages, and then when there was that office in back of Oxford Circus.
It's been upgraded.
Just been upgraded.
Yeah. And you'd walk in and it'd be like a huge box of trainers or a massive consignment of Levi's. Or,
And
Bangs would have done some deal with someone in Japan or something.
Yeah.
And it would be like, oh, okay, clothes for everyone this week. grab a few. Like Tony says, I don't think, more me personally, but I don't think really anyone much on the label, certainly not Shadow or Crush, ever kind of thought like, hey, I'm a wax. Yeah. You just kind of thought, oh, great, I've got a jacket.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Here's my new tune.
Yeah. But the label, I mean,
it was great on that branding.
Bro. Yeah, yeah, exactly. I mean, they came along and they really nailed it with the artwork, you know, for the record sleeves, you know, just the whole kind of ethos and fashion, you know, people, there was a look, wasn't there, you know, and people, you guys probably.
Yeah, were, I think. For,
go on.
For me, by the time it got to action figures for grown-ups, possibly going a little... A little beyond my comfort zone.
Yeah,
agreed.
Yeah, I suppose he's just like a kid in the candy shop, though, wasn't he, James, with all of these things and just
And that was, you know, and that's his fearlessness because, you know, again, James was never concerned with being. Well, it was quite sweet. He was so uncool. I mean, just so uncool because he was just this ultimate geek. But that made him brilliantly cool because he was totally unselfconscious and he had that slightly kind of Tarantino spectrum-y kind of way of, I just want all of this now and not held back by kind of any kind of, I might look a bit kind of odd. But that kind of is where you get the kind of original kind of cook from.
But then also I think, you know, from an artist perspective, I know for me and for, you know, for Attica, you know, just having this opportunity to express yourself, you know, and, have, and being on a label that, that is ultimately about experimentation, do you know what I mean? And has this, you know, underpinned by beats, underpinned by, you know, digital expression, you know, underpinned by sampling. You know, to me, that was super, super exciting, you know, and again, for me, it's definitely the, some of the most formidable parts of my career, my life, because, you know, it was almost like stuff that you're doing in your bedroom 1 week is on a shelf a few weeks later with fantastic artwork, you know, and part, you know, part of this, and it's quite extraordinary. There's this big wedge of, you know, marketing or thinking about artwork or, you know, the music industry side of things that, you know, as an artist, you know, I didn't really care about that then, but I also knew I was in, particularly in the early days, I was part of this kind of collection of people who were really passionate about this particular music and this particular approach to bring out records. So that was super, super exciting.
Yeah, I mean, I've got an amazing opportunities. I mean, I fooled around with DJing-ish at college, but, you know, strictly bedroom with, like, one Technics and something awful. But because of the label and because people wanted to book people who were on the label, I basically learnt to DJ on book gigs I was booked for. I'd literally buy the tunes, shit myself, go out there, and, you know, mix terribly for the first year, and then get there. And it was incredible because the opportunities being over the world as a kind of, I don't know, I was going to say as an ambassador, but that's too pretentious, but because you were on my wax, people wanted you. They wouldn't, you know, I didn't sell enough records for somebody in Japan to say, we want that guy.
Yeah.
But they'd say, we want a flavour of Mo Wax, who can we have?
Yeah.
And one of us would go out and different people. It was mind-blowing, absolutely mind-blowing.
Yeah, so that actually was one of the questions I suppose I was going to ask you, what life was kind of like, if, you know, as a recognised Mo Wax artist, do you think that actually really just had a major influence on, you know, what you guys were able to do in your lives? Do you think that was the catalyst for it all?
I mean, for me, for us, you know, it was almost like a blessing and a curse in a way because on one hand, you know, particularly in the early days, it made a lot of sense because you know, our music was obviously had its roots in beats and had its roots in some, you know, sample-based experimentation. But I think because, for example, we were the only one of the only vocal-led bands on the label. And one of the only projects that had, you know, were a band. Most other people were DJs, producers on their own, making instrumentals. So immediately, we had a slightly different, we were different. It was a kind of different, it was different. You know, we had different, it began to become a challenge because, you know, how we were trying to express ourselves as artists, I don't know, it just became a bit more of a challenge, you know.
Did you feel kind of restricted by, although it was actually a label that gave you free kind of rein to what you want to do, but you, at the same time, you also kind of you were restricted because there was like a...
I was just running joke with my friend Jeremy, where there was a time where you'd go in and James would say, yeah, yeah, listening to the DAT or whatever you were playing it on. And he'd say, yeah. Could you make it a bit more sun roll? And we used to say that, like, what we're going to do is we're going to actually just record some Sun Ra onto a DAC, because I don't think James had actually really knew what Sun Ra was. So we're going to say, we'd like some, like, Duke Ellington-based kind of band arrangements. And it was like, he just thought that there was this kind of cosmic idea of Sun Ra. And so sometimes, you know, yeah, he had his whimsies and he'd want to do things, but he very rarely, I don't really ever remember him saying no. Anything. He might just drag his heels a bit, but it was restrictive in that you couldn't go there with a, you know, you wouldn't have gone there with a house tune particularly or something like that. But for me, I mean, it was an amazing springboard because just as James kind of started getting sucked into the vortex of the kind of the madness of Uncle getting next level, I bumped into Nana Cherry and they were looking for people to do live stuff. And again, my friend Jeremy, who I alluded to, we were all doing the house band at That's How It Is. Yeah. And we basically just became Nana's band.
Wow.
And just kind of jumped onto that. I met my... there you go, That's How It Is.
You're on that record, right?
I met the unfortunately now gone, not of this world, but the best friend I ever had, Johnny Dollar, who's the most amazing producer. He and I then had, I don't know, a decade or more working together. And I got a deal, my deal from Virgin was purely, I think, that they thought they were poaching me. They thought I was hot property on my wax and they were poaching me. Whereas actually at that point, I remember, I was DJing in Japan and I bumped into James in a club. This is what a wanky story. Bumped into James in a club in Shibuya and he hadn't spoken to me for months. I'm not out of falling out, but he'd just been busy. And we'd be talking about me doing an album. And the day before I left for Japan, Virgin offered me a 6-album deal, which I was going to go for.
Wow.
And then I bumped into James. He said, hey, listen, we'd really like to do an album. I think we probably got £1,500 for it. How do you feel, kind of thing? And I realised, okay, I've moved on now because I can't handle... Now the label has become bigger than any artist.
Yeah.
And now the A&R is the artist. It's like, great, brilliant, you do your thing, but now I need to kind of carry on making something else.
Yeah. So that was cool. You got involved with Nana Cherry for a while, and that was, I mean, that must have been... A
couple of years, on her Man album. Did a bit of writing, producing.
Amazing.
And then played live for based out of Spain for the most part, 2 years, where she was living.
Amazing.
Yeah, it's been phenomenal to me.
Yeah. I mean, she's an individual that I never, until... last few years I never realized her involvement in the scene, like, you know, with Massive Attack and
we're going back to Oxford. When Buffalo Starts came out, that was one of those records that, you know, when you're doing so back then, you know, when you DJ at EDSU, you know, this was obviously alongside doing stuff with Destination X, you know, you had the opportunity to, you know, to DJ what was called the Friday Night Bop at Oxford. And remember those days, yeah. Those environments are actually how you learn to DJ, because ultimately most of the crowd wanted Love Cats by The Cure and Sunday Bloody Sunday by U2.
Yeah.
Those are bangers, So you're dealing with kids who haven't brought up, you know, their understanding of black music would be probably Motown, do you know what I mean? Mm. You know, so you have to kind of figure out how to obviously play tracks that aren't too choosy, you know, tracks that you're prepared to play that don't go all the way south, because once you start playing you know, Sunday Bloody Sunday. It's a great record, by the way, but you get my point.
It's no going back.
And if you're trying to introduce, you know, James Brown records or Charlie Rouse, do you know what I mean? Or, you know, or Go-Go, you know, Chuck Brown and Soul Show. You're trying to incorporate that kind of music. It's a real skill to DJ and program your music in a way that appeals to all your heads, but also people who need to learn about what you're interested in.
So
Buffalo Stance was one of those records that was a really good, what I used to call a lifesaver tune, because it was definitely come from our tradition, you know, because I knew she was connected to the Wild Bunch and Massive Attack and all that kind of stuff. At the same time, she was cool. At the same time, it was a pop record, but it had the sensibility that, you know, everyone could get into. You know, there are a couple more records like that. And so another record like that is, say, Groove in the Heart by Delight. That's a fantastic record that you can play anywhere. So so with the Nena thing, you know, it was a really cool situation with that record being, being really accessible.
Well, it's interesting also when you're talking about how you have to kind of bring the dance floor with you. I mean, that summer of 89, I guess it was for me, there's that Delight track, then Do the Right Thing came out.
Yeah.
And that just that whole summer was just that.
Quite the Power, standard, it, remember?
And Quite the Power, and every tune off that album.
Apart from the
reggae tune, which was always weird.
But then also, remember there was the jazz version of Quite the Power.
Bramford Marsalis.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
So that brings me on. What I was going to say was, I remember my earliest memories really of mashups as well.
Yeah.
I mean, from those clubs that, you know, at Bogart's, there were people coming down with, like, mixing up, you know, George Michael with something else.
Yeah.
And just the very earliest days of people doing mashups. Mm. And that was another, like you say, that was another way of making it not so unfamiliar to people who then found themselves, oh, you've just mixed into something else, and suddenly they're left there going, oh, this is fun, I like this. It's not the wonder stuff, but I like it.
Exactly.
So, I'm aware that time's moving on. I've got a couple more questions. This is going to be a hard one for you to answer. If you had to name a favourite artist, track or album from the label, what would it be if you could pick
one? Other than our own?
Other than your own, of course, yeah. I mean, if yours was your favourite, then fair enough.
Tony?
Oh, God,
nicely done.
I have two. So Kamuri definitely was something that was really special.
Yeah.
That when I heard that, it blew my mind.
Yeah.
You know, absolutely blew my mind when I heard that for the first time. And emotionally, I knew that I was in a great home for this kind of music. Mm. But then also, Organ Donor. Because when it first came out, I didn't understand it. I didn't like it, to be honest.
Yeah.
I didn't like it. But part of that tour, when I saw Josh perform it on the NPC, and he multi-pitched the organ, so he did the on the NPC. This was part of his Braveheart tour, and seeing him perform it just on the NPC and seeing how the crowd went absolutely bucky over that record. And I really got it then, and to this day, I've got really fond memories of how that particular formed my perception of that track, and I listened to it, experienced it in a completely different way.
I mean, it was like nothing else you'd ever heard, wasn't it, really, actually?
No, totally.
Simon, you've had enough time to think now.
Two tunes and an artist, can I go with that?
Go for it. So cool.
RPM 2000,
nice.
I think, it still sounds original and arresting.
Yeah.
I think the way the beats work, the way you almost think you might be playing a drum and bass track at the wrong speed.
Yeah.
It's so, all the sounds about it are just lovely, and it's where it's understated but really hard.
Mm.
I love that. And then there was an obscure funk mob 10 inch.
Mm-hmm.
It was a remix. I think it was Richie Horton, I think, did an amazing kind of 110 kind of mid-tempo kind of techno-y kind of thing with it. It was just, and again, one of the privileges of being on Mo Wax was people started asking us to do remixes.
Mm.
And that was a whole eye-opener. And hearing remixes done by people who absolutely just would turn the tune inside out and gut it. And that was a massive inspiration for me. And then Crush has got to be, he's just such an amazing individual. And I did a couple of tours of Japan with him where, you know, my Japanese was non-existent, his English was pretty non-existent. And one tour in particular, which was a slightly dodgy tour that somebody who was kind of managing me in Japan put together. And it was typhoon season, and we were just in this little 4x4 driving around these small towns in Japan playing quite unlikely little clubs.
Mm.
But Crush was just such a gentleman and so welcoming and so humble with such incredible skills.
Mm.
And again, you know, I used to mess about thinking, oh, I could do something with a little delay unit and rudimentary scratching and think it was, you know, and then you just watch him in a very, very matter-of-fact way just devastate people. It was just amazing. Yeah. And I loved the fact that he saw it as a job. He had kids, he had a wife, and he didn't have nothing to do with show business. It got him out of a fairly, he was going down the wrong path from what he was doing before.
Right.
And he just was music, right, fine, I could do this, I've trained, and I'm focused on that. And he was serious, and that was, again, was really lovely.
Yeah, amazing.
So,
okay, you may have already answered this question, but what about your best memory of that era of working with James? Funniest memory, best memory, if you haven't already mentioned it.
Do you know, I know it's a kind of cop-out, but, you know, we're all older now. We've all got kids. Still got that drive for the music, but, you know, the world's moved on in a great way. There's lots of, you know, there's things that I'm doing now I would never dream of doing. You know, a couple of years back, I did an album in Abbey Road with a 45-piece orchestra, 24-piece choir. Stuff, I'm stretching myself still, but I just think that 90 to 94, I just hold that in that kind of magic of youth kind of period where you just, everything was fun, you know, it was just, you know, and I am being nostalgic, but but it was just, everything was so possible,
yeah,
you know, and Mo Wax, for me, it's inextricably tied in with that. So I couldn't pick one, because every day was had something.
Yeah.
Just sitting in front of your S1000 and your Atari, having been able to do that, being on the Enterprise Allowance. Yeah. You couldn't do that now.
Yeah.
Being paid by the state to make beats.
Yeah, yeah, of course. Yeah, didn't Brian Eno say something about the Dole being like the greatest sort of creative kind of funding that we've known kind of thing? Around.
Yeah, I used to sign on in front of Kevin Rowland at Kilburn High Road.
Yeah, okay. I mean, there's definitely something about, look, I mean, you know, I'm sure there's some research that's been done somewhere that, you know, a lot of great art and a lot of great, you know, pioneering music and culture came because artists had the scope and the space to really, you know, craft their ideas, do you know what I mean? You know, supported by the state. You know, I really believe that British culture, you know, art, music, film, you know, wouldn't be the same.
Yeah.
If it wasn't for those years, you know, for sure, because I think it gave people the scope to experiment and explore ideas that weren't necessarily related to, you know, profit, or, you know, it was about cultural statements, artistic statements, you know, first, you know. So I think, you know, I'm going to cop out and I can't really pin a favourite moment because it was all such an exciting time.
Yeah, of course.
You know, and you know, every day was, you know, either stuck in, you know, S1000 or SB12 floppy disks, you know, developing ideas, developing ones. The foundation, you know, definitely like Simon, you know, it's definitely a very grounding, a very formidable time in my career in terms of developing ideas and really honing the kind of sound production programming ideas that I still have to this day. Mm. You know, my approach to music making, my approach to beat making, the way I was able to articulate, you know, really celebrate, you know, the music I was into, hip hop, you know, experimental music, and kind of have a home to explore those different ways, mm. different genres or whatever, and then create music from that, create form, whether it's a song, whether it's a skit, whether it's a remix, mm. you know, that was really honed and developed at that time, and then some from there. So
I totally agree. I think we had this amazing luxury of being able to make music for the making of it,
mm.
and like you say, in exploring, but that becoming the outcome, you know, for the product, for want of a better word, but that just being, we're going to go down this road and see what, that's a record, amazing. Mm. Now we'll go down here, now we'll go down. And James, again, giving, you know, we had time to, you know, I put out 4 or 5 EPs, I think, and loads of tracks on there, and just not having this pressure of, you have to do this, now you have to do this, now you have to do this.
Mm.
You know, it's like development in a sense, which mm. labels don't really do anymore. Mm. And also, you know, paying us to go into actual studios.
Mm.
You know, going into, I used to go to Matrix, used to go into Roundhouse. That's really, really, Maison Rouge.
Yeah.
Really, you know, top studios, and meet engineers who, you know, I don't know what the hell I was doing. I mean, okay. And, you know, it's amazing that technology means that we can all make music on our laptops and you can do it at home. Mm. But we, again, in that random moment of history, were able to take bedroom DJing, but also somebody was, like Tony says, didn't really care about the money, was prepared to say, fine, here's 700 quid, spend 2 days in a studio.
Mm.
And from learning and from quality as well, you know, putting stuff onto 2-inch, stuff like
that. Yeah, totally.
That was incredible.
Yeah, and also that the role that, you know, particularly when you're in the studio, you know, the role that everyone plays, like whether it's from the assistant who's had no sleep because they've been up 5 nights in a row, you know, sorting out cables and cups of tea, you know, to the assistant engineer, to the engineer, you know, everyone has a kind of role to play in the obviously maintaining a studio, but also maintaining an environment for artists and producers to hone their, you know, music, you know.
Yeah,
and even us to this day, some of the, you know, engineers and producers that I worked with back then are still good friends with, you know. It's really, it's super, super interesting. I mean, obviously the same kind of thing, it does exist, you know, and just to be clear, you know, as Simon said, you know, it may sound nostalgic what I'm saying, but I guess the main thing we're trying to say is that definitely being part of Merwax was really formidable time in our lives. And, you know, definitely in terms of where it was in time, you know, particularly with, you know, the advent of digital music making and music making becoming accessible, you know, we were the generation that could make, you know, well, on one hand, we could model our people that inspired us, whether it was a Detroit house or Chicago house, that stuff was made on, you know, secondhand cheap equipment, 808, 909, Juno, what, these were all things that were relatively accessible back then, you know, and things like the S1000 sampler, S950 sampler, you know, these are things that were, you know, they were quite reasonable, but mm. you could really make really high quality results mm. from that equipment.
That was 30 quid in, yeah. And he'll take
things like that. So you know, so I think, you know, at the time, you know, it was almost like it was a really exciting time when, you know, people had the opportunity to make records using this digital technology,
mm.
but also the industry was also ready for it. Do you know what I mean? You know, and the industry was in a different place with different income streams and, you know, definitely a lot of money from CD sales. So it was it was a really interesting time in history, you know. And
people paid for music.
Yeah.
You know, you could survive on, and I'm not saying this as a kind of complaint, it's just a fact. You know, if people were buying a 12-inch for 8 quid, you could sell 2,000 of them and actually
make some money.
All right, because no costs, nothing like that. Whereas paying 79p for a download and you're getting a point whatever percentage of that,
yeah,
you have to sell millions, and that affects how you approach what you're doing.
Mm.
Because, you know, we could, you, there was a, you know, a legitimacy to being niche because it paid its way. Whereas, you know, in a sense, it either becomes an expensive hobby or you have to find a way to reach many, many more people or find another way of making your revenue through live or whatever or anything like that. But the something about the medium of, you know, again, at that time, people were still buying vinyl, which was lucky for us.
So it's almost a perfect segue into bringing us from nostalgia zone into future zone. You know, what are you guys up to these days? You know, I know Simon obviously been following you on Instagram, and you've got this 2020 never be beaten thing going on.
I mean,
what's
it's that?
So what's that, Simon? What's that?
Well, you asked me. Yeah, it's funny because it is. It's a kind of maybe the whole lockdown thing. I keep getting these nostalgia bursts, and I keep reminding me of the summer of 76 and then 80s kind of stuff, and then everything that's been happening, you know, the world going to hell around us has been. So at the end of last year, I was just getting very, very dispirited by what was happening to kind of Brexit Britain and people's ideas of community and how they viewed each other and the rest of the world. And I just thought, look, I can't let this get me too down, and I just need something that is going to keep me feeling like this is not going to beat me. And then I remembered that, you know, it's been so long since I've just sat and made beats and done what was the thing that got me so enthusiastic and then took me on this amazing journey of producing other people and putting out stuff and getting hired and all that, having a career, I suppose. And so I started doing this thing, 2020 Never Beaten. And I didn't even have an Instagram account, so I got one and just thought, well, once a week, I'm just going to beat how I'm feeling. And then there's a few photographers that I know, and I'm going to get them on board just so I've got something for people to look at. And at that point, all that I had on my plate was I just don't like the way this country's going in terms of its little Britain-ness. And then the pandemic, and then the crises around the world of how people are relating to each other, and the Black Lives Matter, and this sense of, we're all just getting squeezed into this space where no one's just got time to share and listen and love and talk. And so it's become really important to me to just keep doing. Now, I'm not sure where it's going. It's essentially hip hop. And I would love to take it to a level now where get some MCs on, get some vocals. And my only requirement is that it's something of substance. You know, I want lyrics of, I come from my, you know, KRS, Chuck D, people who are using MCing to elevate something and communicate, which is, you know, nothing wrong with a party MC, brilliant, you know, absolutely amazing. But for me, I'd like this project to have, not to be political, but just substantial, you know, something that means something.
Yeah.
So that's what I'm up to.
Nice.
It's been lovely, yeah.
Awesome. Watch this space.
You can check it out, Tony.
Yeah, I will do.
Tony, you and I obviously collaborate on CDR.
Yes.
That's how our connection came about.
How long have you been doing CDR now?
Almost 20 years. Yeah.
Amazing.
So in fact, you know, CDR was essentially inspired by some of my, well, it was a knee-jerk reaction from some of my experiences with the music industry, you know, because after we moved from Moax, went to Sony for a while, made a record with Higher Grounds. And, you know, that's, you know, we loved making that record. It was a fantastic record, but it was also a testament to, you know, being in an environment that was more about selling Sugar Babes records, you know, or, you know, whoever it was at the time. But, you know, it was about different things, and it was very hard being in a building like that when you're up against, you know, an environment that isn't about music, it's about, you know, packaged goods, you know. And that really kind of jaded me for a while. And I said to myself that I'd never be in an environment that is restricting again, you know, and actually create environments that are about the opposite of that, you know, about creating a safe space for artists and producers to find their identity, you know, or nurture their identity, I should say, do you know what I mean? And try and make it not about genre, although I have obviously you know, the fundamentals of what I'm interested in is, you know, how people articulate their ideas around black music and how you personalize it and how you express yourself, whatever genre it is, but ultimately it's about that. But it was also about getting people to really appreciate and having a safe space to try ideas, experiment, a bit like being on my laps in the early days, you know. So started that in a small club called The Embassy, which was on Essex Road. It's a really cool, really small space. It was an amazing club. Did a couple of, and I literally just had an idea to do it. So I printed some flyers and stuck them in record shops. And back then I used to burn some blank CDs, put them in a case. And those were the flyers, like blank CDs, inviting people to obviously burn music onto those and bring them to the night. And the first night I did it, maybe I had maybe 50 people, but in that crew, it was mostly my mates, you know, but it was really special because I knew it was special, purely simply because, you know, to contribute to the night, you had to make something, you know, so it wasn't like a normal DJ set where you spend time preparing a box of records and deciding what you're going to play first and what you're going to play peak time. I literally came to the, came to the event with one CD, my own, you know, and the fact that people in the lead up to the night were bringing tracks to the DJ booth. Mm. And the DJ set was basically growing in front of me, you know.
Yeah.
And nice. Rather than it, and you know, usually you know, you're not a DJ. DJ usually comes from, you're empowered by the set that you've created, right? Whereas this was the complete opposite. Like I have no idea what is in front of me. Like none, literally no idea what it is. Mm. And I really actually gravitated. That was like really exciting to me. The fact that I have to make sense of this pile of CDs. I have no ideas what it is, and every, you know, so I curate before and try to get an idea of what the vibe is and play it in some kind of cohesive playlist, but I really liked that kind of risk element of to it, do you know what I mean? And having an event that was about listening to music and creating a safe space for music to grow and evolve, and it's pretty much been that ever since, you know, and it's obviously grown into other things. You know, so the first situation, as I said, was at the Embassy. Then we moved to the Bridge and Tunnel for a while, which is a very special club in London's history. Euphonic Records, did a lot of stuff there. You know, it's a really significant club. And then from there, we moved to Plastic People. Plastic People for a long time. Very, very important club. Very important time in history of London. And we were there until Plastic closed in 2012. And then we moved to Dance Tunnel. Until that closed, but at the same time, you know, brought TDR to different cities, so in Birmingham and to around the country in small pockets, running in Berlin, running in Copenhagen, different pockets, and just basically trying to create this community of and safe spaces for people to share music and grow.
Yeah.
You know, so over the years, you know, some people have gone on to do really good things, which is fantastic.
Yeah.
But that's my thing. You know, I'm just really, I know that. You know, artists, producers need safe spaces to experiment and to try ideas out. There's obviously an industry, there's obviously confines of industry, whether it's sales or finding an audience and all this kind of stuff. But when it actually comes to creation, that should be about taking risks and experimenting. Yeah. And that should be about finding yourself, you know, finding your language as artist and producer. And that's what basically I live for, essentially.
Yeah, and I think what's brilliant about that is there's a danger in clubland and with DJs of, you know, people waiting to tick off the list of the tunes that you've played because they're expecting a certain tune and if you've got the right tune or not. But what you're doing is just completely dismantling that and kind of putting you on the spot in a way that, you know, that the DJ doesn't occupy a position of elite power.
Yeah.
You're a conduit.
Which is fantastic.
It's absolutely brilliant, especially in less now, but you know, back when the awful period of the kind of the super DJs where you were really just like, hey, what is this about? How is this about dub? I think that CDR thing is just amazing.
Cool.
And then fast forward 2020, CDR in a sort of never be beaten 2020, CDR is now going online, I suppose, because of the, you know, we can't do the in-person sessions.
Yeah. Yeah, I was playing because, you know, we've been obviously talking about it for a long time. I mean, you know, what's one of the first things you said to me when we first met? You know what I mean? You're still alive, type. No, I remember that. So, you know, and I think for me, you know, one of the appeals, and Simon's kind of alluded to this, and we've all alluded to this, just this idea of being in a physical space with people, there's something really magical about it, right? Johnny would say to me, that was always something that was really important. But at the same time, online brings lots of opportunity and ways of reaching, you know, a global audience, you know, which is obviously fantastic. And, you know, we definitely were witness to that when we kicked off our online series on Thursday, with this, you know, learning series, I think. We've got a session on Thursday, this Thursday as well, actually, so that should be exciting,
So that's the interactive learning series you're talking about?
Yeah, so that started last week. So we've got, you know, we've got some support from the Arts Council to bring some, you know, to work out ways to obviously support artists and producers, but also to develop some initiatives. So we started this initiative called the Interactive Learning Series, which is about asking producers and artists what they want to learn, do you know what I mean? You know, so we kicked it off with an Ableton kind of basic thing, making an Ableton just very accessible language and very accessible. And then the next one's about sampling and manipulation. And then the following three, we kind of put it out to people, look what do you want to learn? You know, that pertains to, you know, kind of EQ and dynamics, and one around arranging composition, and one around mixing. So that's been really cool putting that together.
I've never learned any of them. I bet I could do it better.
Likewise, you know, but also, you know, I mean, it also, you know, I think for me, one of the reasons why we did it as well, because I think that, you know, as you can hear from myself and Simon's, you know, just what we've been talking about, a lot of what made us is naivety, you know what I mean? You know, and what drove us was obviously our passion for music, but also having vehicles to work it out, you know, vehicles and opportunities to figure it out, you know? And I think to a certain extent, not that it's lost, but I don't know, there's just to me there's a bit of a disconnect between having safe spaces, to learn and, you know, develop, you know, at your own pace and make mistakes, you know, I think because we all live these, you know, kind of like very branded lives. Do you know what I mean? It's like
I think the immediacy and the openness of the internet is also, you know, a creativity's worst enemy as well, because it's like everything has to be, you're putting it up there, and it could be next to a record that cost of £20,000 to make, or and there isn't that kind of, now we're in a small club where people are very sympathetic, I'm just in the big world immediately. And I could imagine, like, I don't really care anymore because I'm an old dad, but if you were young and worried about how you seemed and how you came across, I could imagine that would stifle your sense of individuality a bit, because you might think, I better make it like that because that seemed to go down well. So again, that's part of the necessity of having safe spaces is a lovely idea for people to just kind of create and learn at the same time. Sounds good.
Right, well, fellas, it's been a pleasure to listen to you talk in and hear the stories and everything like that. It's been really interesting. I'm actually going to play a track now, The Beast, but it's a System remix. Is that the Crust remix that you were talking about, Ronnie Size remix?
That's Ronnie Size remix.
Ronnie Size remix. Okay. Well.
And the wow sound is a that.
Wow. Nice. Yeah. So I'm gonna.
Shadow always said he thought it sounded like remember the Atari game Circus, and the clowns that used to go wow.
Yeah, sure.
Shadow always used to think I'd sampled it off an Atari console.
Well,
no,
well, look, it's been a pleasure talking to you guys. Really, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for asking us. Real pleasure. Thank you.
No worries. All right, take care of yourselves.
See you soon.
See you later. Right, bye.
Relax. church of the operating room with the strikes of course, scalpel since the Holocaust. I do indeed in greed explore meet the patients, back in rooms with the nurse with the voodoo curse. Holding up office lights, standing at huge heights, back and forth, left wing, sweep to north, east to south, with blood pouring down your mouth. I can prepare with the white suit and stethoscope, listen to your heartbeat, delete, beep, beep, beep. Your insurance is high, but my price is cheap. The hospital, it's a patient's work to keep the germs off the turf. Cybernetic microscopes and metal antidotes, telescopes that magnify the size of the ghost. Decomputed to cup a corporate planet with my hand and astral planet detached, turned on rare foggers. Cut the light on the kid, turn the bright on. Supersonic waves combine and burn his brain waves. I see the mascot of evil, he's not Knievel. Shakespeare's gone, don't even think about it. Yes.
that I found my fantasy. Now it seems